Catherine Grace O'Connell.
Welcome to Mastering Modern Midlife. I'm Catherine Grace O'Connell, and I am so delighted and honored today to introduce my guest. Amberlee Lago is an amazing woman, a woman who has learned the power of resilience and the lesson in resilience the hard way. She is a best-selling author, an expert mindset coach, a motivational speaker, a mother, a wife, and I like to think of her as superwoman. So welcome to the show, Amberlee. I am so delighted to have you here today. We've been working on this for some time, huh?
Yes, we have. I am so grateful to be here. Thank you for having me on your show. It feels like a dream come true to finally get to have this moment sitting with you right now. So thank you so much for having me.
Oh, absolutely. It was what, last spring? I think it was maybe the beginning of March. Is that when we met at the Maymusk event?
It was right before COVID. It was
right?
How I remember. It was like, that was my last like road trip before COVID. And I met you and it was just love at first sight. We were like soul sisters. I don't know how to explain it, but when I saw you and we started connecting, it just felt like home.
So it did.
Yeah. So that was such an incredible event too. I'm so glad. It took me like 2 hours to drive there. And I was so glad that I made that drive because I made some incredible connections. I made a connection with you. So thank you, my soul sister. And thank you for that lovely introduction.
Oh, you're so welcome. The universe seemed to kind of conspire to put us together. We actually ended up coming in, seeing each other, just kind of gravitating toward one another, and then sitting next together, like with beautiful May right in front of us. And I know you've had her on since, and talk about jealousy. I'm going to stalk that woman and get her on my show too.
Yes. And actually talk about technical difficulties. So I had her on my podcast the first day that everything shut down for COVID, like all the businesses, gyms, restaurants, everything shut down. So everybody was doing things through Zoom. And during my interview with her, twice Zoom just stopped working, and she was so kind and hung in there and continued the interview despite stopping twice. I was just like, I have May Musk on the show. And she was so gracious. I think that we really see somebody's true colors and what kind of person they are in the rough times.
I don't want to jump in there, but I mean, talk about an opening to the show, really learning about a woman's true heart, true colors, inner strength, because that's really what we're here to talk about today, is you, the best-selling author of True Grit and Grace, Triumph Over Tragedy. You know a thing or two about triumphing over tragedy, don't you?
Well, a little bit. It's interesting when you read somebody's bio and you're like best-selling author or whatever. Sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, that's me. I'm an author. And the reason I know about resilience is just because I have failed and been broken and hit rock bottom and overcome 34 surgeries and, just really been through a lot. And about 6 weeks ago, my daughter and I were hit by a car again. So I keep holding on to my thumb. The last thing that hurts is my thumb because I put my arms out in front of the car to try to stop the car from hitting her, And so the week before that happened, I guess we were walking into Michael's and Ruby looked at me. I guess I was limping a little bit. She goes, Mama, I don't think you have any lives left. I think you have used all 9 lives. And I said, you know what, baby? I think you're right. I think I got to live full out. Well, like a week later, we both get hit by a car. And as we're being, she's on a gurney. I was well enough to sit beside her and we're loaded into the ambulance. And I looked at her. I said, well, I guess I had one more in me. I got one more.
Oh my goodness. I missed that. You have a lot going on social media and that world. So somehow I try to hop on your page because it is just such a feast for the soul. And I'm so sorry But I miss that. You seem to have, like your daughter said, 9 lives, 10 lives, 11 lives, 12 lives, multiple acts, multiple reinventions, multiple ways of, you said, transforming tragedies into triumphs. So your book actually talks about another accident, a just soul-crushing accident, literally and metaphorically, that your soul has somehow managed to really rise. But you had an accident then, a car accident, then a motorcycle accident, and now this. So let's go back to the book and talk about really what the book is about, which is rising from, you said, being literally, metaphorically, and figuratively crushed.
Yeah, I really, you know, I had everything going for me. I was living a good life, finally. I mean, I'd been through 2 divorces. Mm-hmm. I had worked my butt off to build this successful business that I had for, you know, I was a fitness trainer and I had trainers that worked for me. I was the main breadwinner of the family. Mm-hmm. I had a new baby girl. I mean, we had a baby when we thought we were told we wouldn't be able to have any children. And so life was really good. And I remember thinking, oh my gosh, this is the California dream. I'm finally living the dream. Like, I've worked so hard, I'm finally here. And I was coming home from work that day. I had finished running 11 miles in my best time with my workout partner. And I was coming home from work on my motorcycle, beautiful California day, could feel the wind through my hair. We were getting ready to celebrate a holiday weekend. And I look over and there's an SUV and I made eye contact and I thought, well, I thought he saw me. He shot out of the parking lot so quick and I couldn't do anything but try to let go of the clutch and jump off my motorcycle. So I was T-boned. I was hit. I was thrown 30 feet and sliding across the asphalt. I remember just thinking, please don't let another car hit me, because I was on Ventura Boulevard, which is, anybody who lives in California knows, it's a really busy boulevard. And when I finally came to a stop, I looked down at my leg once and then I didn't want to see it again because it was broken into pieces. It was completely, it's crazy to look down and see blood squirting out, your foot dangling off. And I felt like my leggings were the only thing holding my leg together. And I just started shouting out, you know, help. I was afraid to let go of my leg because I really thought it might fall off. I felt like I was holding my leg on my body. And I remember thinking, well, this can't be good. I might have to train clients on crutches for a while. That was like one of my first thoughts was, what can I do? What am I going to do next? I had no idea how it was going to change the rest of my life so drastically. I had no idea that my femoral artery was severed. I was bleeding out. So I got on, the paramedics came, I'm taken to the hospital. And it was just crazy in the hospital. My husband, being a lieutenant commander with the highway patrol, news travels fast in the brotherhood and sisterhood of the police force. So the whole hospital ER was just filled with cops. And it was chaotic. And my husband was there, but I couldn't see him. And all I could hear was this loud, like wailing, like a crying, but like I'd never heard before. And I realized it was my husband, and he's a big, strong guy. I'd never seen him cry. And that freaked me out. I thought, oh my God, am I going to die? And at that moment, I yelled across the hospital. I was like, honey, get over here now. I need you to be strong for me. And he came over and he held my hand. And that's the last thing I remember before a nurse, her name's Shaniqua. I'm still friends with her. She leaned over me and she said, we're going to give you something to make you feel all better now. And they put me in an induced coma because I was literally dying on the table. My organs were shutting down. Mm-hmm. I had lost so much blood. And when I woke up from a coma, they said, you've got a 1% chance of saving your leg. We're going to have to amputate. It's basically a war wound. There's nothing we can do. And I said, whoa, wait, you said 1%. You said a 1% chance. So let's find a doctor that's going to be willing to try for that 1% because I'm willing to try. And that 1% was my glimmer of hope that really got me through months in the hospital, 34 surgeries in total over the last years since the accident. And piece by piece, they were able to put my leg together. And that was actually really, that was hard, but that was easy compared to the diagnosis I got next, which was from complex regional pain syndrome I was diagnosed with, which they said, you're never going to get better. There's no known cure. That is when my healing journey truly began.
Yeah, you talk a lot about, there's a lot of clearly pain, physical pain, emotional pain, mental pain, spiritual pain, all those things. And I remember there was another piece of the puzzle here when you were there and listening to your husband crying and said, hey, wait, get over here. This is the tough Texan girl saying, wait a minute, I need you to be in charge because I need you to keep me together. And one of the nurses happened to say something like, oh, okay, I know what we're dealing with here because you are someone who isn't easily defeated, isn't easily, no matter what they show you, be it the 99% chance you're going to lose your leg, you're going to grab on to that 1%. And you did, and you saved your leg. But that wasn't the end of the story. That really was the beginning of the story, like you said. So let's go back to that moment. You were in the hospital. Like you said, there's 34 surgeries ahead. Clearly, what was that now? Was that 10 years ago?
10 years ago. Yeah.
10 years ago.
Yeah. And it's funny you brought up the nurse said that now we know who we're dealing with. When I went back to the hospital just so I could thank her because she was like an angel leaning over me. And she said, girl, I knew who we were dealing with when you yelled across the room. It was like E.F. Huffing or, you know, like the commercial where when they talk, everyone listens. It was like it went silent, like dead from chaos to silent. But I really needed to know that he was going to be there to hold it together for our daughters, you know? Mm-hmm. And so that's what I had the moment of, I might not make it out of this. I need to know you are going to be able to keep it together and you're going to be strong for our kids. And I needed him to be strong for me. I needed him to just pull it together. You know, I don't know. My whole life for some reason I've been very good at being able to remain calm during crisis and pause and think about my default is what can I do? What, not why me, poor me, but what can I do? What's next?
You were kind of groomed in that in growing up. You did not have, you know, your book obviously shares some very colorful stories, very vulnerable stories, everything from, you know, clearly sexual abuse that was transformative in learning, like you're saying now, how to be the strong one. And sometimes you have to step back and that awareness, that incredible awareness. You talk many times about the power of mindset and all those lessons from, you know, early on in life. So you had two other marriages, right? Mm-hmm. You were sexually abused by a stepfather. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Stepfather. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then
I used to be really embarrassed about admitting that I had two failed marriages. But you know what? That shame is such a heavy emotion. And I've just learned that, I mean, I've had a lot of shame about a lot of things I've done or that have happened. And when we hold on to that, that holds on to us, that weighs us down. And so I think that writing my book and being able, there's something really cathartic. There's something very healing about, you know, from your thoughts and pen to paper. And I mean, I wrote my entire book by hand and then went back and typed it up. And I think it comes out differently. When I try to type something, I'm trying to make it perfect and make sure it's just punctuated right. And when I wrote it, it came out differently. But I realized I hadn't healed from a lot of the trauma that had happened growing up and then an abusive marriage. And until we can let those feelings come up and slowly process them and feel those feelings, then we can truly heal them. And I'm telling you, when I was able to finally let go of that shame and step into, you know, my power of just, and it's really about acceptance. It's really about just accepting what is. Yep, this happened and that was a terrible situation, but I'm not going to let it control the rest of my life. So I had to learn how to really build my self-worth, mm-hmm. get my dignity back so I could walk through life with my chin up and keeping my side of the street clean and not letting actions of others weigh me down or you know, and learning when to let go of old stories that I told myself. And so I think that being stuck in a hospital bed for so long, and when I say stuck, I mean, mm-hmm. I was completely bedridden. I couldn't even stand up to use the bathroom mm-hmm. on my own. I had to depend on somebody to carry a bedpan for me. And that was probably the hardest situation I was in, because I realized at that moment, the only tool that I really had was exercise and running. Running was my therapy. When I felt sad, I'd run and I felt better. When I felt anxious, I would run. I mean, I remember being a kid, I discovered running and I literally became such a good runner. I set a record in Texas for the fastest mile. I ran. And I ran from everything, and I ran from my feelings, and I didn't process things. I just ran, and that worked until it didn't. And it was not until I was stuck in a hospital bed and I couldn't run and everything piled up and I couldn't suck it up anymore, because suck it up works until it doesn't, that I had to go, oh my God, I need some new tools, because nothing was working for me.
Being a former runner who had some similar things, I totally get it. I get the running being metaphorical and really taking a physical way to work out a lot of those things, to run mm-hmm. from things, but also to run out all that stuff that's building up inside. So let's go back to shame. That's a really, really fundamental piece of your younger years. And you shared, you know, there was some shame about having two failed marriages, but by the same token, those perceived failed marriages led you to a pretty special man in your life, the love of your life.
He's my hero. Yeah. I mean, I'm lucky he puts up with me.
Oh, I have a feeling he has a different perspective.
He puts up with a lot.
You're so cute. But I mean, you tend to flip it around a lot in your life journey and taking the negative and turning it to a positive. So it sounds like over this time, you know, those aren't failed marriages. They were practice for something pretty special here, because you have, without this guy by your side, I cannot imagine those former husbands by your side during what you went through.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and, you know, I had a therapist tell me something that really changed. It was hard to hear at first. I was in a terrible relationship. I kept picking the same kind of guy, mm-hmm. like in a different outfit. I'm like, oh, this is the one. I'm like, oh, he's just like the other one. And the therapist looked at me. I went and I said, can you believe he's talking to me like that? He's doing this and that. And she goes, we teach people how to treat us. Mm-hmm. And she looked, she goes, you teach him how to treat you. Wow. And that was like pointing the finger at me, like, okay, what can I do differently? Why am I allowing this? Because it's so true. We teach people how to treat us. We set our boundaries. We own our self-worth. It's up to us to decide, do we love ourselves fully so others see the value and love us too, you know? And
so
that's
powerful.
Something I had to learn.
So powerful. It basically encapsulates midlife to me. And midlife isn't an age, it's an experience. It's that time in our lives when we sort of pivot both internally and externally and change from, you know, this world where we're taught to be something, told to be something, should be something, to who we choose. And much like you, you know, letting go of things of the past or really examining internally how we got to where we got so we can really pivot and create a healthier life going forward, which you really did. But back to that same piece, I really want to talk about, you share some really unbelievably vulnerable moments in your book, and sexual abuse from a very close family member, which is, I understand personally, having gone through it, how devastating and soul crushing it is. So I'd love to talk about that, because we have many women out there in our audience that share similar stories, because much of your story is a very deeply personal story, but it's also a universal story. There's a lot of universal themes in there and ways that you healed later on, but really helped you see your past in a different way. So I want to pick that up about that shame piece. And you know, you were really close to your mom throughout the theme. She's there in the hospital. You know, there's this wonderful relationship. But by the same token, you were carrying a lot of shame about being sexually abused by someone and not telling your mom, and certainly not telling your dad till much later. So let's talk about that for a moment and how now, looking back, that really changed your life, changed you internally, but ultimately you were ready to talk about it and help other women.
Well, it's interesting, you know, well, first of all, the hardest part to write about in the book was the sexual abuse, mm-hmm. because I didn't want to hurt anyone, especially my mom. So I let her read the manuscript, and it was really hard. I mean, we've talked much about the mm-hmm. sexual abuse since then. And I let her read the manuscript, and it was really hard for her to read. And she said, "Amberly, can you just add in the book? If I would have known, I would have done this." And I said, "Mom, this isn't a book about woulda, coulda, mm-hmm. shoulda. This is a book about the, well, I don't know if I can cuss on here, but when yeah. things, when shit hits the fan, when things don't go as planned, when awful things happen, when tragedy comes, when trauma happens, when sexual abuse happens, what are you going to do next?" Like it. And the thing is, we have the power within us to choose. And I think once you realize you have the power, you know, you have a choice, then you take your power back. But that was really hard to write about. And, you know, when I was little, I didn't tell my mom because my stepdad was really scary. And when you have someone that is bigger than you, scarier than you, has a lot of guns, has a knife collection, and he was really crazy, telling you that they're going to kill your mom if you say anything, I believed him. And so by the time I was about 13, you know, growing up and not feeling like I had a safe place to go, I lived at the dance studio a lot. That's where I felt safe. So I constantly kept myself busy. I dove into school and became an overachiever in everything in school. I was president. I was president of the French club. I was a cheerleader. I was choreographing for drama, straight A honor student. I was Miss Greenville High School. You name it, I was like the fastest runner.
Go, 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 go.
Yeah,
until the universe basically, literally forced you to stop and forced you to stop and really pivoting your life then in an entirely new direction where you become this amazing mindset expert, resilience expert, pacer, all these other things that have beautiful tools you've brought to the world. So we're going to dive into all of that in just a moment. We'll be right back. So I want to pick up right there in a story that you share in the book, a story that was really profound for me. I grew up in an alcoholic household. So you were such the perfect daughter from what I could see. You did nothing wrong. And then there was an experience where might've been your first taste of a beer or alcohol or something. And
yeah, my brother gave me a beer. My brother, who, mm-hmm. you know, we're friends now, but he used to beat the crap out of me. And I remember he gave me a beer, and I remember thinking, wow, why is he being nice to me? Like that, I thought that was nice to give me a can of beer, a Shiner Bock. And I drank the beer, and I thought maybe this is his way of like bonding with me. Mm-hmm. Little did I know, just like the next day, he was using it to blackmail me. Well, then he told my mom. I remember my mom came in the bathroom and she was like, "I can't believe it. My whole image of you is shattered." And I remember thinking, you know, she said, "My angel, my whole," like I was so bad and I was so wrong. And I already felt so bad because of what sexual abuse does to you. They make you feel like it's your fault and you're the bad one. And now I felt worse, you know, and that's just a horrible, horrible feeling to experience. So when I finally did have enough courage to, and I think enough desperation and fear, I went to my real dad, mm-hmm. who my parents were separated, and they lived not far from each other. And we would stay with my dad every other weekend. And I went to my dad and I told him, and I said, look, you can't tell anybody, but this is what's going on. I promised I wouldn't say anything, and I'm not supposed to tell, or he could hurt mom, but this is what's going on. My dad didn't do anything.
And that was devastating in your book. Sorry. Devastating when you share that.
Well, you know, writing it in my book, and again, I let my dad read the book, the manuscript, before it was published. And since the book, my dad and I have actually gotten closer, and he's apologized. And he said, you know, you made me promise not to mm-hmm. tell anybody, and mm-hmm. I didn't tell anybody. And I was like, but yeah. I was a kid. I was screaming for help. I wanted you to protect me. But in that moment, when I didn't have anybody coming to rescue me, mm-hmm. I actually ended up standing up to my stepdad one night when he came in to try to attack me again. And he was a big guy. And I stood up to him and fought him off of me and kicked him and punched him as hard as I could. And that was the last time he ever hurt me. But I also learned to not cry, which wasn't good. Mm-hmm. You know, he used to really tell me all these horrible things and try to beat me down. And when I would cry, he would laugh at me and say, see, I knew I got you. Mm-hmm. I knew I'd make you cry. Mm-hmm. So my other defense was, well, I'm never going to cry. He is not going to get the best of me. I'm not going to cry. Mm-hmm. So I had a lot of stuff to work through as I got older. It took me years before I learned to cry again. And once I finally let all these emotions rise to the surface, holy cow, it was hard. I think I cried for a year straight. I was a mess.
Floodgates.
It was the floodgates because, you know, then, you know, as I got older and I started feeling it was too much to feel at first. And that's when I started drinking myself, you know, and I grew up with alcoholism around me. But I always was like, oh, I'm so different. I'm the go-getter. I'm the athlete. I'm the achiever. I'm the Miss Fitness girl. I'm the, you know. And then I realized, holy cow, man, this alcohol helps with my pain, helps with numbing out all these feelings that I have. And this is, why didn't the doctors just tell me to drink a glass of wine every night? And, you know, that worked until it didn't.
Until it didn't.
And yeah. I woke up one day thinking, how did a good girl like me end up like this? And, you know, here's the thing. Addiction does not discriminate. Mm-hmm. Alcoholism doesn't discriminate. And luckily, I thought, I want more out of life than this. This cannot be my life. And I think sometimes, you know, I had to hit that rock bottom. Mm-hmm. Here I'd survived this horrible accident. I was slowly killing myself by drinking.
What I feel, sorry to interrupt you there, but I feel it's so important because you're so real in the story and the alcohol. I saw on your Instagram, I knew from your book that you'd had that, clearly got into alcohol as a way of numbing, which many people do, be it, you know, for me, maybe shopping for, I grew up in an alcoholic family, so I get that. But I think that there were pictures on there. I could not believe like the before and after. So talk about hitting rock bottom and what it was doing to you internally. Like you were puffy, these things that we do to ourselves and you would never know today. You look at you. You are the ultimate superwoman. You're spectacularly beautiful. You are so crazy, wonderfully fit. But it was like this glow that I could see from the pictures before when you were drinking. Again, not to me, there's no shame in that. That's pain. That's what we do to numb our pain. But what I see is the triumph over that. You have triumphed over so many things. Addiction, sexual abuse, crazy car accidents, suicide, diseases, illnesses, all these things that you've had to overcome. Talk about suck it up, buttercup, all those things you say in there, the tough little Texan, you know, girl in there that has been so amazing. Again, these universal themes that are in your book but these stories we tell ourselves. So there was something in one of the interviews I think you shared about, it was a quote from Brené Brown that was really inspiring. It was something to the effect, which maybe you know it better, like don't share your pain until your scars, like you have a scar, like not when it's a,
well,
a gaping
wound. I think it's important to share your story in a safe environment, and that's how I started. But to share from a scar and not from an open wound is very important. And the thing is that, you know, we all, the human spirit is powerful, and we all have those superpowers within us. I'm not special. I'm no different than anybody.
I'm not sure many people would read your book and not agree to that you're pretty special, but okay, don't want to interrupt again, but I can't, you're pretty special. You read that book and you can't help but think you are a special soul with a special human spirit.
Well, thank you. You know, I really find my strength and my joy when I can help others turn their can'ts into cans and start to believe in themselves and their limitless possibilities. That's where I find my strength and my joy. But I say that I'm no different than anybody. It's just we all have that ability to tap into our superpower of resilience. And the thing is, we have to work on it every day. We have to be willing to show up and take a good hard look at our life, what we're doing, where we're going, and what we want to do. And that's hard. That's not easy to take a good hard look at your life and maybe something that you're not happy with or something that you know you shouldn't be doing or maybe a habit you know you need to break or something that you need to change or something that you want to transform. But that's the key and the first step into making your life the best that it can possibly be, whether it's recovering from addiction or disease or trauma or feeling stuck and really wanting to thrive in life. And so we all have that capability.
Like you said, it's easy to look at the good parts, right? The hard part is going and opening up inside and going, okay, I have these pain points inside of me, things like you said, carrying shame. But every time we open up about shame, we bring it out into the light and you help
shine
others.
Shine
light on it. We shine it on ourselves. And then you go out there and you start sharing these stories and you become just this amazing magnet. So resilience. Resilience is a powerful theme. It's what you have really become an expert in. What's your definition of resilience?
Oh gosh, I think that resilience, I told somebody the other day, I said, you know, I like to help people strengthen their resilience. And I had this guy go, well, resilience isn't a strong enough word. It means to bounce back. And I said, no, I'm changing the definition of resilience. And I said, I don't think resilience means to bounce back. I think it means to bounce forward and reinvent yourself. And really, it's finding the courage to move forward and live a life filled with laughter and love, even when things don't go as planned. So I think that resilience is getting up again and again, despite our failures. It is being able to, I think a word of 2020 was pivot, but I think it's really being able to, in 2021, say, yeah, maybe things aren't the way that I would ultimately like them right now, but what are my possibilities? What can I do? And I think one of the ways to really be resilient and help with your mindset so you can keep moving forward is to practice gratitude is really big for me. For me, gratitude is alchemy, and it turns what we don't have into what we do have and what we can't do into what we can do. And so I practice, and I say practice gratitude because like we build our resilience every day, we build our confidence every day, we have to practice gratitude. And so I wake up before my feet hit the floor and I say a prayer and I thank God and I ask God, please lay in front of me today what you would like, what my purpose is, how I can be purposeful, how I can be useful in the world. Please speak through me. And whether you want to call it God, I call it God.
Right. Your relationship with a higher power, whatever you want to.
My girlfriend says Gus, meaning God, universe, and spirit. Mm-hmm. So she says Gus. Let Gus drive the bus. Oh. And so I like that.
I call her Gussie because I think she's a she, because I think the she's are like spirits as they come. But I totally, it's so important to have that relationship with something bigger than ourselves.
Well, and in that picture, you said you saw that you, me, the before and after when I was drinking versus when I'm sober. that what you saw, the light in me was about out. It was like barely a flicker. And it's because when you numb out, you cut off your connection with your higher power. You cut off your connection to your inner wisdom and your intuition and your spirit. And so I think that when we can do things to make sure that light in us is burning bright, you know, be around people that we love and that are positive and passionate, like you, Catherine. That's why so many people are drawn to you, because you're such a light. And so I think that once I got sober, slowly the light started to come back in me. But it's not like we have to keep doing things to make sure it keeps shining bright.
Keep the light on, because every time you shine light, well, there comes another shadow, right? And another one. And that's the whole healing process. We don't shine the light once. We have to keep bringing it back and bringing it back. And, you know, that's the intent, like you say in your book. You choose. Every moment is a choice, right? We have a choice. We can go down that spiral, I think, when you were talking about after the accident. And there's the before, Amberly, right? All the things you could do before. You could run, you could dance, you know, obviously you've come back to a lot of those things now. But really, if we compare the person in that hospital bed who's got the leg that is just unbelievable to see with the prior self, yeah, we're going to go into despair.
But it's so funny that you say that. My daughter, my youngest daughter, I had posted some transformational picture and it shows my leg in the hospital. And she's like, "Mom, you really need to like put a trigger warning on your pictures." And I'm like, "What does that mean?" She goes, "You need to warn people. They're going to see something really gross. Okay." And I was like, "Thanks, Ruby."
Oh, I'm hoping we're after post-production, we'll be putting some of those amazing photos in here, because they are amazing. They are hard to look at. Of course, they're hard to look at. They are very triggering, but the same token, they're so empowering to see where you were, to where you've come. And there's more coming to do. There's more things on the way. There's more learning on the way. There's more lessons. There's more pain. Because every day you live with pain, not just clearly there's a lot of emotional pain in life and what you've overcome, but physical pain. Mm-hmm. What is this? Sorry, I know it's four letters. My notes disappeared with that word.
Yeah, no.
But it's the
complex,
suicide.
Complex regional pain syndrome. Right, it's dubbed the suicide disease because it's ranked highest on the pain scale. So I'm passionate about sharing that, because look, I had shame about that. I didn't want people to know that I had some disease or something wrong with me. I didn't want people to know that I was in pain. So I still struggle with that. I think from growing up a dancer, and you know, my teacher taught me, I don't care what's going on in your life. When you put the needle on the record and you turn around to teach your class, you put a smile on your face. Again, like that, suck it up. I was taught, suck it up, cowgirl up. And with chronic pain to this extent, I tried doing that for a long time, and you just can't keep sucking it up. I had to learn to listen to my body more. And I'm so passionate about sharing about CRPS, because if someone is first diagnosed with it, if they take radical action and get spinal blocks or treatment or you know, ketamine infusions or a spinal stimulator, their chances of going into remission are greater. There's a girl that reached out to me. She heard me sharing about CRPS. Her name's Patty, and she was a Pilates instructor, and she had a ski accident, and she was diagnosed with CRPS, and she sent me a DM on Instagram, and she said, "Amberly, I know you don't know me. I just got diagnosed with CRPS and I'm really scared. And I said, can you call me?" She called me. I never talked to this person, didn't know her, got her on the phone, started talking to her. I said, "When were you diagnosed?" I said, "You need to go to a pain doctor now and tell them you need radical treatment." She got in remission. She had spinal block after spinal block, but that's because she reached out. And that's the great thing about social media now, is you can find people that are like-minded, that are CRPS, what I call CRPS warriors. And in fact, I just started on Clubhouse.
Yes, I know. I'm seeing you on there. I'm stalking you on there too. And hopefully we'll do something together. But
Absolutely. But I just started a support group for people that are living with chronic pain or CRPS or trauma to come in and share their experience, strength, and hope. And I always set the room with, we're going to share, you know, what you're, I set it up for, like last week, my friend Wit came in and she just had her leg amputated. And she's like, I really need a Twitter fire set. Can y'all please tweet this? And so we all in the group, we all tweeted. So it's a place to come for support, share tips that work for you. And I couldn't find a support group that wasn't really downer. Like, I, you know what? It's hard living with chronic pain. I don't want to sit in a pity party all day. I want tips and solutions and what is working. Yes, it's okay.
What advice do you have for someone who finds you on social media or goes into your Clubhouse room and looks at you like, oh my God, okay, my pain isn't as bad as her pain. I can't possibly open up because she's so fierce. She's been through this stuff. Mine's like, you know how we marginalize, we again tell ourselves these stories. My pain isn't as big as yours. What do you tell women like that to be able to go join your room and not feel intimidated and understand that we all have different pain and it's not all the same, but it's all really important to talk about?
Well, that's one of the reasons I started this support group is because I wanted a place where people can be shoulder to shoulder. It doesn't matter what you've been through, who's pain, you know, there's a lot of support groups with a lot of comparison. And I didn't want that. You know, everybody, pain is pain. And we all deal with it differently. But if we come together and we share what's working for us, then we find solutions. Then we find support. Then we find love. And it's not about who's got it worse, who's had it the longest, whose scars are the worst, who, whatever's going on. It's about how can we rise above this together and support each other through it. And you wouldn't believe the transformations I have seen from, I met a few of the CRPS warriors that were in a book club that I was doing. And I'm telling you, Catherine, it was like night and day. You talk about that light that goes on in someone, just learning these mindset hacks and the PACER method and how to do certain think, how to shift your perspective differently. These women went from victim, like really this, why me, this disease own me, to victor. They're now not just in my support group, they've started their own. And that's what we want. We want to, you know, spread our message. We need more women and more empowered women. And so I think that, you know, it's easy, it's normal, it's human to get in that comparison trap.
But it's female. It's such a female universal story where no matter what, we are always judging ourselves and putting ourselves down, including how, you know, our stories aren't painful enough. There was a story I think I heard of Will Smith the other day. He was talking about trauma and he's like, absolutely, those things are not your fault. You are not responsible for those things that happened to you, but you damn well better believe that you are responsible for getting past them, over them, healing them, diving into them. And then ultimately, like you're doing, going out there and sharing that and helping others, you know, through the amazing work that you're doing. One thing before we kind of wind up and make sure we let people know where to find you if they want to work with you, because you have so many incredible gifts and you're offering out there right now. But, midlife. Okay. I always say midlife isn't an age, it's an experience. So when I'm turning 60, I still consider myself like midlife and beyond. But you are 49, turning 49 this year, but 50 next year. So what has been the greatest surprise of almost being, you know, turning 50, greatest surprise and greatest blessing of being older, being in this whole almost 50 plus world?
Let me tell you, the greatest surprise is the day you wake up and you're like, how did my skin get loose like this? What the hell is going on?
It's so true. I don't see it in you. I don't see it in you, but yeah.
When did that happen?
I have long sleeves on.
What the heck? That's a surprise. It's like, yeah. Oh, when did that happen? You know, that's a surprise. The blessing is that, you know, you just don't care as much about. For me, I'm just like, it is what it is. Honestly, I'm happy to wake up every day and be able to walk and breathe and have a pulse and see my daughters and play at the barn, have a break in the middle of the day to go to the barn with my daughter. I mean, there are so many things when you really get grounded in gratitude, it really mm-hmm. allows you to shift your perspective and see all the things and yeah. all the blessings that there are. Because just like when you were talking about in the groups, like women comparing themselves, mm-hmm. it's like, if you can look at that as, you know, when I see somebody, a woman that's very successful or who's so beautiful, I always tell them, and it gives me hope when I see somebody that is extremely successful. I'm like, if they can do it, I can do it too. And I like to surround myself mm-hmm. with the most beautiful women. And it's interesting because I had this one friend that she took a picture and she photoshopped her face and everything.
And another body.
And she didn't do anything to me. And I was like, dude, if you're going to Photoshop, at least give me a little Photoshop. You know, but she just did herself. And I said, you know what? I'm the opposite. I'm the kind of girl, woman, midlife woman, I guess I should say. I forget how old I am sometimes. That I want to shine a light on my girlfriends, and I want to like make them, not that I want to Photoshop them, but I want them to be seen in the best light. I want to be hanging around successful people. I mean, I think so much, you know, as I've come to realize, I think when you get older, when you're younger, you might have a ton of friends, but when you're older, you might have fewer friends, but they're the friends that really count, that really
matter. It's different.
Mm-hmm.
It's different, isn't it? What I actually shared that in my blog post yesterday, it was about as we deepen into ourselves, which I think is the midlife, I feel is the midlife experience, that whole phoenix rising. But as we start peeling those layers and shining light in the dark spaces and getting to know ourselves in a different level, on a deeper level, our friendships deepen. Everything out there really is reflected by what's going on inside. It isn't always fun to go in there. It isn't, but it's awesome on the other side, isn't it?
Yeah. And don't you feel like you can, like, I don't know. I just feel like when I meet mm-hmm. a woman with a beautiful heart, that's mm-hmm. a giver and a lover and just a girl's girl, mm-hmm. you can feel it. And I think that's one of the reasons, like when I met you, I was like, she's a girl's girl. Like, she's a girl's girl. Like, that's what I always say. Like, it's like a girl code thing. Like, yeah. you know, you got each other's back.
So it's so true. And like you said, it's that glow. It's the glow of the heart. You know, that's, I think, the light that not only do we see, but we feel. But I think that was one of the things that was so, the light that we can see, we can feel. When someone has a beautiful heart, you can't help but feel it. You can't help but be drawn to it. And that's an amazing thing to share with women, that if they could just work on one thing, it's just like being that little better human, which just puts a little more light in our hearts and becomes this magnet.
We need more powerful women. We need all those women to stand out, use their voices. Yes. And that's one of the things I like about Clubhouse, is we are getting some badass women on that Clubhouse stage. And I love women supporting women. So
I do too. I'm going to be up there with you. You're going to come with me. I'm going to come with you. I'm just going to budge my way in. It's just how it goes. Cause I think, you know, you're awesome. And I love the message that you're putting out there. I love all the things that you're creating at Midlife and Beyond, all this whole new, 10 years ago was your accident. Look, in 10 years, all the best-selling book, TED Talks, all kinds of wonderful programs.
I have another TED Talk coming up, I'm doing another TED Talk, and I don't even know what the outline's due this month. I don't even know what the message is going to be.
It's going to come through. You know, I know you. You're going to bucket up, Buttercup, and that message is going to come through, and you're going to rock it out there on that TED stage. You're going to figure it out. So we have amazing women out there who are dying to connect with you, check out your programs, check out your book. Please let them know where they can connect with you, and maybe just three quick action steps that they can take after they watch this show today. Maybe go check out your things. What are three quick things that they can do? So first of all, where can they find you? And then just three really quick action steps they can take.
Okay, yeah. You can find me at AmberlyLago.com. And I hang out behind the scenes, Amberly Lago Motivation. You can see my crazy videos and my stories and stuff, or come to my room on Clubhouse. It's support group 8 o'clock on Fridays and noon Pacific on Fridays as well for the support group. And three things that you can do today, three things that changed my life, completely changed my life. First, take a look at your life and where you're going, what you're doing. Take a look and really take radical acceptance. Get grounded with gratitude every single day. That changed my whole mindset, and that's something I practice every single day. And then reach out and share your gratitude with somebody, or reach out and ask for help when you need it. Because when you reach out for help from somebody, it shows that you respect them, that you have trust in them. And that was hard for me at first, but reaching out for help changed my life. And I mean, heck, reach out to me. You can text me at 818-214-7378. And if you want I have a Goals, Grit, and Grace playbook. It'll kind of outline everything for you to keep you on track with your goals. If you just text the word GRIT to 818-214-7378, you'll get your downloadable playbook. Because it's one thing to hear a story, but if you can really take those action steps to follow up, that's when your life starts to transform. So yeah, please. So, and Catherine, I love you. Thank you so much.
I love you too. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me on. I appreciate getting to share here on your beautiful platform with your audience. So I just admire you, and I appreciate you having me on.
Thank you so much. It's a big love fest here, which is a great way to wrap up this show. So you guys, I think those are great lessons to leave with: acceptance, gratitude, reach out and ask for help. And I'm so glad that we reached out to one another and have been, developed this amazing friendship and mutual respect. So thank you so much for being with us today. And thank you to my beautiful community out there. Thank you for being with us. And please check out Amberly, all the amazing things she is contributing to the world, and her wonderful book, True Grit and Grace, Triumph Over Tragedy. Thank you so much, beauties. With that, cheers, beauties. Stay fierce.